all seasons this week. We've got sunshine today, a little warmer weather. We had snow yesterday coming down. Interesting times for sure, but we're glad you're here with us this evening in the sanctuary, and for those of you who have signed in online or will watch the service later, we welcome you as well to this service, which is intended to be a midweek recharge service to get you between now and Sunday again, when we can worship again back in God's house. So before we begin this evening, we always try to begin in prayer. So if you'd pray with me this evening as we begin. Dear Heavenly Father, I just thank you for this day and for the opportunity we have to worship you. We just thank you for this midweek service. We thank you for all those who are here in person and those who are listening and watching online. We just thank you and we just praise you and for all that you do. And all that we do is for your glory. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So, for those of you who followed last week, I started a series called Win the Day. And we talked about 7 daily habits to help you stress less and accomplish more. Stress less and accomplish more. And it's based on a book called Win the Day. And so last week, we learned about the first habit, which was you have an opportunity to rewrite your story. You have an opportunity to rewrite your story. And this week, we are going to talk about something a little different. If you had an opportunity to read the devotion this week that went out last night, one of the things I talked about in the devotion was that God has designed us to handle hardships. I talked about in that devotion an airplane ride that I had, which was very difficult from Washington, D.C. to St. Louis a number of years ago that I will never forget. And these are opportunities that we have in life where our faith is forced to grow. And it's a time in your life when you can get discouraged very fast and you can lose hope really fast in the moment. Or you can find hope in the moment. I'm sure there's been a time in your life when you wanted to give up. You just felt like throwing in the towel. You just felt like quitting. Maybe it was a job. Maybe it was a relationship. Maybe it was who knows what. But we've all had those moments in our life where we just wanted to give it up. So tonight, I'm going to start with a song, and this song is going to lead me into what I want to talk about tonight. And this is an old song. I haven't done this song in a long time. I put Mary Lou on the spot this afternoon, so she hasn't had a chance to really play this song in a number of years probably, but we both heard it. It's a Ray Bolt song, and it's called The Anchor Holds.
I have journeyed through the long dark night, out on the open sea. By faith alone, sight unknown, and yet his eyes were watching me. The anchor holds, though the ship is battered. The anchor holds, though the sail are torn. I have fallen on my knees as I face the raging seas. The anchor holds in spite of the storm. I've had visions. I've had dreams. I've even held them in my hands, but I never knew they could slip right through like they were only grains of sand. The anchor holds, though the ship is battered. The anchor holds, though the sails are torn. I have fallen on my knees as I face the raging seas. The anchor holds in spite of the storm, but the anchor holds, though the ship is battered. The anchor holds, though the sails are torn. I have fallen to my knees as I faced the raging seas. The anchor holds in spite of the storm. Amen. The anchor holds. Amen. Amen. Thank you. So this evening, get this pulled up here. We're going to talk about holding tight to the wave. Holding tight to the wave. The big idea tonight is this: learn to hold on to the wave that throws you against the rock of ages. Learn to hold tight to the wave that throws you against the rock of ages. By doing so, you will find strength through life's storms. We're going to read this evening from Mark 4, 35 through 41. Very, very common scripture. I'm sure many of you maybe have this memorized. And it goes like this, Mark 4, 35 through 41. And that day when evening came, he said to his disciples, "Let us go over to the other side." Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along, just as he was in the boat. There were also other boats with him. A furious squall came up, and the waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly swamped. And Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion, and the disciples woke him and said to him, "Teacher, don't you care if we drowned?" And he got up, and he rebuked the wind, and he said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." And then the wind died down and it was completely calm. He said to his disciples, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" They were terrified and they asked each other, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." We have a choice in life, and the choice is this. We can either let obstacles destroy us, overtake us, knock us down, or we can use them to our advantage. We can choose to be victorious despite tragedy and pain. Mark Batterson, who wrote the book Win the Day, has this to say about the choices we make regarding our obstacles. You may not be responsible for the difficulties you've had to endure, but you are response-able. Response-able. At the end of the day, your explanations are more important than your experiences. The obstacles we encounter are not the enemy. The enemy, more often than not, is us. The enemy, more often than not, is us. The obstacle. The obstacle, believe it or not, is the wave. Choosing to not let obstacles or the waves of life destroy you is in no way denying that the waves exist. We know they exist. And we know they're hard when they hit. Sometimes unbelievably hard. Choosing to not let the obstacles or the waves of life destroy you is no way denying they exist. I say that again for emphasis. We must not ignore that bad things happen. Doesn't it just drive you crazy where people are like wandering around and, you know, like, as long as you don't think bad things, they'll never happen. Wouldn't that be great? We must not ignore that bad things happen. We need to accept them, but we do not have to let them overtake us. Instead, we can make the decision to find purpose in the pain and strength through the tragedy. Everybody knows who Michael Jordan is. Michael Jordan has been praised to the skies and is often referred to as the best basketball player of all time. He attributes his success to his many failures because he has claimed they made him try even harder. They certainly did not discourage him. When he was just a very young boy, he was not even thought of to be a great talent. He was cut from the high school basketball team. He has actually counted his failures, and they include 300 lost games, and he has missed taking the game-winning shot 26 times. Most champions are discouraged and unmotivated by their failures, but Michael Jordan, his attitude was the right one, and he regarded them as a recipe to his success. In Mark's gospel, we find the account when Jesus calmed down the storm. The disciples panicked when faced with the wind and the waves. But Jesus reacted very differently, didn't he? Rather than become fearful, Jesus said, "Be quiet." Now, we don't know exactly how he said that or with what vigor he said that, whether it was a whisper or whether it was a shout. It has exclamation points, but I don't know the interpretation. "Peace, be still." And after the storm calmed, Jesus asked his disciples, "Why are you so afraid? Have you still no faith?" And in this account, Jesus challenged his disciples to kiss the wave and embrace their own courage and their faith through the storm. He assured them they had a choice to make. They could either panic and be afraid, or they could have faith and trust him. Your choice, and you have to make one. Oftentimes we find ourselves in the same proverbial fork in the road when we encounter obstacles. And Jesus asks us, "Why are you still afraid? Have you still no faith?" Often when we go through seasons of suffering or pain, we're eager to get out of those situations, aren't we? Sometimes we focus so hard on getting through them that we forget to grow through them. it's often beneficial for us to look for the lesson in the middle of our suffering season and ask God, what are you trying to teach me by making me go through this? What are you trying to teach me through this? It is through this introspective process that we begin to grow through our suffering rather than allowing the suffering to diminish us and our faith. Mark Batterson illustrates this concept through the story of how he and his wife had to grow through a season of suffering when she was diagnosed with breast cancer. This diagnosis could have destroyed them, but instead they used it to their advantage by growing through it. They not only grew in their faith, but they took the opportunity to remove all the toxins they could from their life. And they were very deliberate about what they allowed in their lives from that point on. Mark Batterson says of his wife, Laura kissed the wave. How? She participated in her own healing process by making some courageous changes. She became intentional about everything she put in her body and in her mind. Along with changing our diet, we did our best to eliminate toxins in our environment, and that included people. Sometimes God delivers us from suffering. In fact, most of the time He delivers us from suffering. More often than not, He delivers us through it. What this means is that we can find purpose through our suffering by discovering ways not only to help ourselves, but help others as well. Have you ever noticed that through your suffering that you learn to relate better to others who are suffering? The way that God uses suffering for the betterment of our lives is the way that we develop a deeper empathy for those who suffer after us. When we grieve the loss of a loved one, we're able to better understand the emotions and the pain somebody else goes through when they grieve a similar loss. When we find stress and frustration through trials, we're able to relate to someone who also experiences these anxious moments in life. It's not for nothing that we go through suffering. A Russian physiologist by the name of Ivan Petrovich Pavlov once did an experiment to see if he could condition dogs to salivate for something other than food. Common scientific experiment, probably most everyone's heard about it. Pavlov wanted to condition these dogs by sounding a buzzer every time he would feed them so that they would begin to associate the sound of the buzzer with food. And eventually, Pavlov's dogs would salivate at just the mere sound of the buzzer, even when no food was presented, because the dogs were conditioned to respond to the buzzer rather than the food. There are many experiences in our lives that we have conditioned ourselves in one way or another, and some are good and some are bad. Our past hurts can condition us to trust a little less, or use sarcasm as a defense mechanism. Too often we let pain condition us by owning us rather than taking control of the past and owning it instead. It's hard to let go of present tense concerns and future tense anxieties, but nothing is harder than letting go of past tense pain. It's that memory of pain. How do we let it go? We own it. So it doesn't own us. We take full responsibility for everything in our lives, even those difficult moments that God is giving us to learn from. When we let the past control us, we surrender ourselves to unhealthy coping mechanisms that can keep us trapped in time. We often fixate on feelings we felt during the trauma when it was experienced, and we use that as a way to even develop unhealthy habits. In order to avoid these unhealthy habits, we need to self-evaluate the coping mechanisms we may have unintentionally initiated that are sabotaging our growth. This bad thing happened before, so I'm going to put up a roadblock. I'm not going to get hurt by this. I'm going to wish it away. I'm going to toughen up. I'm going to deal with it differently. But it can sabotage our growth. It's imperative to identify and interrupt these unhealthy patterns. If you want to win the day, you've got to self-scout. You've got to identify the ways in which you sabotage yourself and then interrupt those unhealthy patterns. Just like coping mechanisms can be unhealthy for our growth, we can sometimes allow our past to form emotional scar tissue that builds up in the form of unhealthy defense mechanisms as well. As a result of emotional trauma or betrayal, we can allow unforgiveness to build like scar tissue around our hearts that lead to bitterness or even resentment. The only way to avoid these defense mechanisms is to employ forgiveness when we experience emotional trauma or pain. That's a lot. The only way to avoid these defense mechanisms is to employ forgiveness when we experience emotional trauma or pain. Forgiveness, while not easy, heals the heart in a way that allows us to move forward and away from unhealthy defenses that are keeping us from winning the day. God can heal you of past trauma and pain. And through that season of suffering, where you were allowed to grow healthy attributes along the way, what you do with this newfound healing is really, really important. It's not enough to simply be healed by the divine power of God. It is also vital that you develop healthy habits moving forward. Not repeat the same mistakes that you made before. You must form these new healthy habits to replace the old unhealthy coping and defense mechanisms that hold us all back. Otherwise, we fall right back where we were, or worse. God has designed us uniquely. I told the story in the devotion about being on the plane trip from Washington, D.C. to St. Louis, and it was just this horrible, horrible experience. We were on the tarmac, and we were waiting at what seemed like forever, but probably 45 minutes or an hour, and we were on the tarmac, and we thought, oh, flight's going to be canceled, bad weather, whatever, and all of a sudden, the pilot comes over the intercom, he says, we're going now, get everybody set down, we've got a window, it's now or never. And let me tell you something, now or never was not encouraging. And we went lickety-split down that runway, and the plane was bobbing the whole time. You could feel it shaking as we picked up momentum. And I've never in my life been in an airplane when on the lift we were shaking so bad that we were for sure that we were just going to be slammed right back to the ground. I didn't have faith in the pilot, didn't have faith in the co-pilot, didn't have faith in that plane. I don't know if I had much faith in anything at that moment, but I can tell you what, I was praying pretty hard, and I can tell you everybody around me was praying something to somebody. I can't tell you it was God, but there were things being said, let me tell you. But God's designed us to handle hardships. Now that's a unique experience that forces you to grab your faith where you belong. You grab your faith and you hang on to it tight and you say, God, you got to get me through this. And it's the same way with the experiences that we have in life, these traumas that we get hit with. They're so much like that airplane ride when they grab you and they grip you and they want to tear you down. And if next time I went to get on an airplane, I kept all that baggage with me, and I continued to harbor on this like I am through this story, I'd never fly again. Habit one, rewrite your story. Habit two, use the obstacles in our life to grow our faith in God, to grow our faith in God, so that in good times and in bad, we are fully prepared. We're fully prepared to forgive. We're fully prepared to have joy and experience the opportunity we have to bask in God's glory for what He's given us. Use the obstacles to your advantage. God can heal you, and God will heal you through focus, through prayer, through forgiveness. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I just thank you this evening for the opportunity to share your word and this scripture from Mark, and we know this story oh so well, and how it's just so easy when life grips us and grabs us, and we're just hanging on. We just don't know what to do. We do know what to do, but we instantaneously we just lose our faith for a moment. Not really losing our faith, but we're just not relying on you the way that we should. The anchor holds, like the song says, the anchor will hold. We're firmly planted in you, and we know you'll get us through all things, no matter what the storm, no matter how big the waves get, no matter how repetitious the waves seem to come, one right after the other, we know that you'll hold us there. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your love and forgiveness, for it's in your name we pray. Amen. This evening, before we close, we like to go through our prayer concerns, and sometimes it seems like that list is growing more than our praises get reported, although I will start with a praise tonight that my grandson, my newest grandson, Ashton, who had it was 5 hours plus surgery yesterday on his cleft palate and his nose, and everything went remarkably well, and he's doing great. They're already home. And it looks like a very positive result. So we thank God for those gifts that He has given us. Even though that tragedy leading up through that birth, that fear that the parents had, my daughter and her husband had, about what this child was going to look like and how it was going to impact him and all of that. And now it's like, whew, now we can breathe. We have to have faith. Prayer concerns continue to be with Polly Smith, with Nick Schilt, with Gail Canavan, with Garrett Smith, with our young people who are going to be completing their course and confirmation, and three of them will be confirmed this Sunday. Two are yet to be baptized, but three of the five will be confirmed this Sunday. For Andre's brother and for your family, Andre, we continue to be in prayer for all of you. For those who have been traveling, for churches in our community, for the homebound, for those who are in our nursing homes. Brady is here tonight. He's up in the sound booth. Him and his family were really sick last week. If you know, he wasn't here on Sunday. Teresa Carter, again, continue to be in prayers for her. She's here tonight. We're thankful for her, but we need prayers for her continued fight against her cancer. for those that we may not have mentioned. Is there any other prayer concerns that I've missed that we could voice quickly?
Garrett Smith.
Still not doing well from COVID. So let's lift these folks up in prayer this evening before we close. Dear Heavenly Father, I just lift all of these mentioned up this evening. And we pray for each and every one very distinctly that you comfort them, that if it may be your will, that you heal them, that you give them hope where there has been a bit of hopelessness set in, that you give them encouragement, that you give them strength, and that you give them a revealing of their own faith, of their own grit, such that they can handle the waves. They can handle the hits. If they put their faith in you, we know that all things are possible. But we lift them up to you because you are the healer. And we know that you know each and one of every one of these concerns. You know what their issues are. You know what their difficulties are. You know all of the people who are involved. There's always so many people who are peripherally involved in a situation where someone is either ill or hurting, or either mentally or physically. And we just pray that you be with this group of people. I pray for the churches in our community. I pray for Faith Prez as well as all the other churches in our community. I pray that people come back to the sanctuary, that people come back to their churches and begin to start a new season of prayer and plant their faith. We thank you for all of your love and your forgiveness and your mercy. We know we don't deserve it, but you give it to us as a gift. We thank you for your son, Jesus. We thank you for the resurrection. Be with each and every one here this evening as we depart. Give them safe travels home and safe journey back on Sunday. For these things we ask in Christ's name. Amen.